As an excellent tradition of the conference, ICRA 98 publishes video proceedings covering new and significant experimental results, demonstrations, and industrial case studies in robotics and automation. The purpose is to enhance and complement the results presented in technical sessions and published in CD-ROMs. This year's video proceedings includes 27 segments categorized into the following 8 groups: teleoperation, rehabilitation robotics, humanoid robots, robots in games, mobile robots, manufacturing automation, manipulation and control, robotic subsystems. Calibrated Synthetic Viewing, USA.
An initial version of a computer vision-assisted calibrated synthetic viewing system has been developed at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. This new technology enables telerobotic servicing with high precision alignment, which is critically needed for the International Space Station robotic maintenance to cope with occluded and limited camera viewing conditions. The high precision alignment capability of the calibrated synthetic viewing is demonstrated by inserting an orbital replacement unit, or ORU, into its receptacle with a 1/4-inch clearance. In the operator control station, the operator interacts with the calibrated synthetic viewing software through a high-performance graphic workstation. First, the camera calibration is performed by matching the 3-dimensional graphic model of the ORU to its actual camera views. With the operator's initial course adjustment, the edge-matching-based computer vision algorithm solves a least squares solution to determine the position, orientation, and the field of view angle of each camera. After the camera calibration, the object localization is performed. The operator first provides an initial course adjustment of the receptacle pose, and then the edge-based object localization algorithm is applied. Now, a newly developed 20-variable least squares algorithm updates both the camera and object models simultaneously. Note that both ORU and the receptacle models are now very well aligned for both camera views. After the simultaneous update, the system knows the receptacle pose relative to the ORU and the robot arm, and commands the robot arm to move the ORU to the first target position 8 inches in front of the receptacle. After the ORU is moved to a new target position, the ORU localization is performed to correct slight misalignment. Now the robot arm is commanded to move the ORU to the second target position, 4 inches in front of the receptacle. ORU at alignment. The ORU is now inserted all the way in without force compliance control. This performance clearly demonstrates the high precision alignment achieved by the calibrated synthetic viewing.
Real-time system for virtually touching objects in the real world using a high-speed active vision system. Japan.
This video shows a real-time system for virtually touching objects in the real world by transforming the object's image to a force representation. A tactile sensor is usually used with a slave arm to realize haptic feedback in a teleoperation system. But this method has several problems, like instability and delay in controlling the arm. We tried to solve these problems by using a vision sensor instead of a tactile sensor, That is the concept of modality transformation from images to haptic information. The system consists of a high-speed active vision system, the Phantom haptic interface, and a DSP system. A virtual finger exists around an object, and an operator controls the position of the virtual fingertip by moving his own finger in the gimbal of the Phantom. The orientation of the active vision system is controlled by panning and tilting, so that the active vision system senses images around a virtual fingertip. The LED array shows the image of the active vision system. The center of the image corresponds to the position of the virtual fingertip, so the approach of an object to the center of the image means the virtual fingertip approaches the object. The DSP system calculates a virtual repulsive force against a virtual fingertip from impedance parameters and the distance between the virtual fingertip and the surface of the object. Then the Phantom exerts a force on the fingertip of the operator. In this demonstration, the fingertip of the operator moves because of a collision between an object and the virtual fingertip. The use of the active vision system reduces the size of the images to be processed because the vision sensor can track only the necessary part of the image. Moreover, this active vision has a parallel processing capability, so the rate of the transformation in the system is as fast as about 200 Hz. Thus, the operator can touch an object that moves or changes its shape at high speed. The system can be widely applied to haptic feedback based on the shape of objects in the real world.
VR training system for crane considering adaptation to operator skill. Japan.
Cranes are frequently used in construction sites. Skilled operators are demanded for safe and efficient crane operation because crane operation is very complicated and difficult. We made VR training system based on our research. Operational assistance system using interactive adaptation interface. Operational assistance is consisted of many kinds of information. Visual display. Shadow. Allow. Side view. Bars. Top view. Auditory display. Boom's velocity. Payload swing. To perform haptic display, we propose a new joystick. The joystick has some actuators and vibrators to show proper control method or payload swings. The video shows automatic separation of payload swing using proposed proper control method. The purpose of this study is acquisition of the control method that is skilled to stop the payload swing. We performed an operational experiment. The aim of the experiment is to stop the payload swing as fast as possible. The system assists operators with haptic display, proper control method, and the system adapts the strength of the haptic display to operator's skill level. The operator's skill level is inferred using recursive fuzzy inference.
Facial 3D pose and eye gaze direction estimation based on robust real-time face tracking. Australia.
This video demonstrates our visual human-robot interface based on facial gestures and the gaze point of the operator. The facial features of the operator, marked with a small dot, can be tracked reliably using a network of Kalman filters. Even after the person leaves the image, the tracker is able to re-establish tracking after the features appear in the field of view. If only some features get occluded temporarily, other features can still be tracked even under rapid motion. As soon as the occluded features reappear, the tracker re-establishes their locations based on predictions from the visible features. The recognized facial gestures are displayed in the bottom left corner. Another aspect of the interface is the detection of the gaze point of the user. The squares on the forehead symbolize the eyes and the direction of gaze. It is calculated from the relative positions of the corner of the eye and the iris. To determine the three-dimensional gaze point of the user, the relative direction has to be calculated, as well as the pose of the head. In this sequence, the three-dimensional pose of the head is estimated based on the image positions of the features. The displays on the left, top, and right of the image indicate the rotation of the head model around the X, Y, and Z axis. The widely used affine transformation algorithm proposed by Huttenlocher and Ullman is used for pose estimation. By using multiple feature triplets in different planes, the ambiguity in the solution can be resolved with a probabilistic interference algorithm. All modules shown in this video are able to run in parallel at video frame rate.
Hydraulic Parallel Micromanipulator. Finland.
Micromanipulation has many exciting areas of applications. Biotechnology, microsurgery, assembly of microsystems and testing of microelectronic circuits. Breakthroughs in gene technology, human genome project, curing AIDS and cancer, all will need micromanipulation techniques. Microsurgery, assembly of microsystems and testing of microelectronic circuits are other emerging applications. Microtelemanipulator makes remote handling of microscopic objects possible. Microscope and the vision system provide the user visual information about microobjects and the operating needle. The operator controls the micromanipulator either using a joystick or PC keyboard. The micromanipulator itself consists of three actuation systems. Each actuation system is composed of a piezoelectric actuator and bellows. The piezo element is placed in a tank filled with hydraulic oil. By changing the lengths of the bellows, the orientation of the mobile platform and thus the position of the tooltip can be controlled. The orientation is measured using three Hall sensors. The micromanipulator has sub-micrometer resolution. The vertical bar moving across the display is human hair. The manipulator can be operated either semi-automatically or manually. In addition to high resolution, the micromanipulator has a large workspace. The micromanipulator is shown to separate glass balls having diameter of 30 micrometers. The different nature of the microworld must be taken into account in micromanipulation. In microworld, electrostatic forces are more dominant than gravity because of the scaling effect.
Human-machine cooperative telerobotics using uncertain sensor and model data, USA.
Human-machine cooperative telerobotics using uncertain sensor and model data. At the University of Tennessee at Knoxville, we are doing research on using the uncertain information gained from sensors and environment models to assist in human-controlled teleoperation. The input device on our test bed consists of a force-reflecting 6-degree of freedom Craftmaster hand controller. It commands a 7-degree of freedom Robotics Research Corporation manipulator, which has end-effector mounted force and distance measuring devices. The commercial software control shell allows modular construction of real-time system controllers as graphical block diagrams. We have written several new components that provide variability in system parameters necessary for our assistance concept. According to our strategy, the remote manipulator remains directly controlled by the operator. Human-independent parameters, such as velocity mapping and impedance, are varied automatically to the extent that the sensors and model data are accurate. Assistance strategies in the form of functional parameter variation are formulated offline and applied when specific subtasks are encountered. Our system is based on impedance control, where the shaded impedance and velocity scaling parameters remain variable. In the experiments conducted thus far, the velocity scaling is of primary interest. Approach to a surface was used to demonstrate this concept. Illustrated here is the relationship between the accuracy of the distance measurement, whose distribution is shown at left, and the velocity scaling as a function of distance, shown at right. Less error in the distance data enforces a more rapid approach and deceleration, while greater error produces a more constant scaling and thus more reliance on the operator for deceleration. The end effector was commanded by the operator to approach and make contact with a surface. The blue curve shows the impact force, the lower pink curve shows the master command position, and the upper red curve shows the slave position. When velocity scaling remained a constant 1:1, high impact forces were incurred. When the velocity scaling from the master to slave was determined according to the laser rangefinder accuracy and distance to the surface, the slave automatically decelerated as it approached, even while the master motion remained constant. Thus, lower impact forces were seen. In conclusion, we have shown that teleoperator performance may be augmented using uncertain sensor and model data through alteration of human independent parameters such as master to slave scaling.
Design and virtual prototyping of rehabilitation devices. USA.
This video program illustrates the methodology for the design of customized assistive devices that help people with disabilities in activities of daily living, such as feeding. In order to make the product reliable and inexpensive, and to enable the user to operate it using proprioceptive feedback, the feeding devices shown here are designed to mechanically attach to the user's head and have no electronic components. A quadriplegic may use the head and neck movements to control the movement of the feeding utensil to scoop food from the plate and bring it to the mouth. The rapid product realization of such customized rehabilitation aids is achieved by the integration of tools from virtual prototyping, mechanism design, computer-aided design, and rapid manufacturing into a unified framework. The customary iterative redesign using physical prototypes of proposed designs involves considerable expense of resources and time. Virtual prototyping enables the designer to kick the tires of the design in the virtual environment and shorten the iterative design cycle. Consider the exemplary case study of the design of a head-controlled feeding device for quadriplegics. The considerable variability in performance and capabilities across the population and the extent of the disability creates a critical need for customization of such devices to each user. Our method emphasizes the acquisition and use of kinematic, geometric, and physiological information about the user to aid the process of customization. This acquired information is used to customize a model of the human in the virtual environment. The TCL-TK widgets enable the designer to change dimensions of the device interactively to accommodate the variability in the population. Other tools developed from dimensional synthesis and optimization of mechanisms assist the designer when the manual selection of the best configuration of the devices becomes difficult. The final dimensions of the design product are propagated parametrically to the CAD package and a physical product then prototyped. The inclusion of the customization at the preliminary design stage prior to the rapid transition to a final design aided by the automated tools is a characteristic feature. This methodology of customized design can be extended to many products that are worn by human users and that need to be customized to the individual user.
A robotic orthosis based on mechanical compatibility with humans. Japan.
A robotic orthosis based on mechanical compatibility with humans. For robotic orthosis having mechanical contact with humans, it is very important to guarantee safety. For this purpose, we have developed a robotic orthosis which is smaller and lighter than electric or pneumatic driven systems developed so far. To realize safer robotic orthosis, small and light actuators with mechanical flexibility are needed. We have developed a hexahedron rubber actuator, HRA, actuated by pneumatic power. As the HRA is directly set at each joint of the robot, gears and pulleys are not needed and the total mass and inertia of the robot are reduced. Without use of pneumatic power, this student moves the 4 degrees of freedom robotic orthosis to produce the forearm motion of a patient or trainer. Its motion almost covers the motion area of a human forearm. The robotic orthosis is moved by a hierarchical control scheme. In a typical use of the robotic orthosis, a physiotherapist teaches a desired trajectory and the orthosis repeats it under his supervision. As the system is very light and its stiffness not high, the therapist can easily move the orthosis with the patient's arm if all valves are open. The system has a mass of 3.5 kilograms and volume of 1900 centimeter cubed, and it generates a maximum force of 100 newtons at the tip under a 0.2 megapascal balance pressure. The desired trajectory is realized using the hierarchical control scheme in which a desired pressure pattern is determined by a position feedback loop taking account of hair compressibility and friction nonlinearities. Gravity compensation is also included. Since two HRAs are antagonistically used in one joint, the stiffness of the robotic orthosis can be effectively controlled by changing the balance pressure in the HRAs of both sides. This experiment shows that the inherent compliance of air compressibility is changed when all valves are closed. In general, mechanical flexibility does not directly mean safety because flexible joints can store elastic energy. However, since the robotic orthosis developed here has a small mass and inertia, it is easier to guarantee safety in comparison with previous electric or pneumatic driven robots.
A virtual environment with haptic feedback for the treatment of motor dexterity disabilities. Italy.
In this video, we present an immersive virtual environment system including visual, auditory, and haptic feedbacks, which has been designed to help to recover the motor dexterity of the arm and hand of patients affected by disorders of motor coordination. A sensorized glove has been assembled with a right arm exoskeleton, featuring 5 actuated and sensorized degrees of freedom matched to the user arm kinematics, to obtain an interface capable of force feedback on the user hand. The arm exoskeleton weight is compensated by its control system. Head-mounted display and headphones are employed for stereo vision and specialized auditory feedback. The medical protocols devised for the virtual environment consist of simple actions which the patient is requested to carry out. Here you can see a healthy subject lighting a gas flame up using a lighter. Moving a coffee pot on the flame. Trying to catch with his hand a flying toast that pops out of a toaster. Grasping and moving a glass. Pointing with his hand at a flying ball. A new kind of biofeedback is realized, displaying to the patient an image changing with his elbow joint angle while he feels a spring-like resistance to his motion. To improve motor coordination of the head, the patient controls with his head movements a spotlight. Avoiding collisions with virtual objects is also practiced as a basic skill. The physically based simulation allows to compute interaction forces between the patient's limb and virtual objects. A series of hierarchical layers of balls which envelop the object's surface are used for an efficient check of collisions.
Anthropomorphic head-eye robot WE3R. Japan.
We have developed an anthropomorphic head-eye robot WE3R. This robot has two CCD cameras at its eyes and two pairs of eyelids. The eyelids is composed of a tunneling frame and a skin-like cover of rubber. On the upper eyelids, there are eyelashes made of metal wires connected to a touch-sensing module. WE3R closes the eyes quickly when someone touches the eyelash. WE3R can adjust to brightness using the eyelids and the neck. When an object is too bright, the eyes are narrowed or closed, and the neck is moved backward. WE3R pursues an object in three-dimensional space with its two eyes cooperatively moving with its necks and eyelids. When the object's brightness changes, WE3R uses the eyelids and the neck to adjust the brightness. If the object is extremely bright, the eyes are closed and the neck is twisted. This is the state of losing sight of the object. When WE3R discovers the object, it blinks and continues pursuing the object. In this manner, WE3R pursues an object very smoothly while adjusting to the brightness of the object. In addition, by adjusting the ears, sound localization is possible, so WE3R can pursue an invisible object that makes a sound. Thank you for your attention.
A human symbiotic humanoid, Hadley 2. Japan.
Here we propose a next generation robot named Adelaide 2, which realizes symbiosis with human. Adelaide 2 was developed by four collaborative humanoid research groups of Waseda University, specialized in the fields of vision processing, nerve system, motion control and language communication. This scene, Adelie 2 finds the talker, looks in the direction of the talker, and communicates by using natural language. She is now shaking hands. This is one of the physical interactions Adelie 2 can do. To start these communications, humanoids need to have the ability of identifying the position of the talker. Adelie 2 does this by first calculating the brief position of the human from the visual information of the CCD cameras. Next, the sound source positioning result and the average sound pressure information is integrated, and the position of the talker generating the voice is identified in real time. Here, Adelie 2 is doing a cooperative task of manipulating a block. In order to realize cooperative tasks according to the human demands by natural language, Adelie 2 is equipped with a continuous voice recognizing system, a voice processing and behavior control system based on state transitions was also developed. Adelie 2 corrects the maneuvering error in comparison with environmental information through the visual system. She can decide her behavior by communicating with human and also the environmental factors. Recognition of the environment is done by comparing the edge contents of the environment model with the color vision from the CCD cameras. A compliant manipulator was also developed concerning safety and human adaptation whilst in physical interaction with the human. This arm realizes ideal flexibility and adjustability, for it has a passive impedance control mechanism. Adelie 2's ability of physical interaction and communication was realized by the integration of these systems.
Intuitive control of a planar bipedal walking robot, USA.
Spring Flamingo is a planar, bipedal walking robot with actuated hip, knee, and ankle joints on each leg. Series elastic actuators control the torque at the joints. This actuation technique allows for the use of motors and transmission with high friction while still maintaining accurate torque. Joint torques are dictated using virtual model control, a descriptive control language which uses simulations of virtual components as if they are attached to the robot. At the highest level, intuitive control strategies determine which virtual components are used. These strategies stabilize height, pitch, and speed. Virtual components also control support transitions and swing leg placement. Feet and actuated ankles help the robot walk smoothly and efficiently. They also allow the robot to balance with its legs together. Spring Flamingo can walk over 15-degree slopes with only a few simple modifications to the flat ground algorithm. The robot detects the slopes blindly, using only its feet to feel the terrain. This is similar to how an animal would sense the terrain if its eyes were closed. Spring Flamingo demonstrates the utility of simple, intuitive control strategies for planar bipedal walking.
Automatic parallel parking and returning to traffic maneuvers, France.
At INRIA Rhône-Alpes, we have developed and tested automatic parallel parking and pulling out maneuvers on an experimental electric car. The car can be driven manually or move autonomously with automatic steering and velocity control. It is equipped with various sensors, including sonars, to monitor its surroundings. When he wishes to park the car, the driver starts the automatic parking mode and leaves the vehicle. The planning and decisional architecture allows the sequence of autonomous motions to be controlled in real time in classic traffic situations within a parking area. The car moves autonomously in the lane. Its real-time motion sequence control ensures safe operation in a dynamic environment. The car avoids collisions with other cars and obstacles. It continues the motion when the lane is free. When it detects a free parking space, the car stops at a starting position in front of the space. The system computes appropriate steering and velocity controls for a nominal trajectory leading to the parked location. A backward parallel parking maneuver into the space is then performed. Once the motion is carried out, the autonomous system decides whether a suitable parked location has been attained. If necessary, additional iterative motions are performed within the parking space. When the lateral displacement of the car is sufficient, the car adjusts its location to midway between the front and rear vehicles to ensure a proper distance. For automatic pulling out, the required steering and velocity controls are planned and executed. The car moves to an appropriate spot at the rear of the parking space. Then, control commands are planned for the subsequent motion. The car turns and moves forward to leave the parking space. It stops in the traffic lane and is then ready for further manual driving. Our future work aims at integrating the automatic maneuvers we have developed into a novel urban transport system based on a fleet of dual-mode electric cars. A preliminary manual-mode version of this system with 50 electric cars is currently under evaluation near Paris. The future version will include all the automatic maneuvers we are currently developing.
Development of a bipedal humanoid robot, Wabian. Japan.
Humanoid projects aims at the development of an anthropomorphic robot that shares the same working space as well as common thinking and behavior patterns with human beings. As a prototype of the project, we develop a bipedal humanoid robot, Wabian. The height is about 1.6 meter at standstill condition, the total weight is 107 kilograms, and it has total 35 of active DOF. The robot is composed of 5 main parts as shown here. We propose a control method of whole-body cooperative dynamic pipe walking for being able to plan arbitrarily in the motion of the lower limbs and the trajectory of the hands. The control method uses the trunk motion to compensate for 3-axis moment generated by both upper and lower limb. We perform walking experiments with the humanoid robot Wabian using control method. As a result, we realize dynamic for carrying of a load with both arm. Also, we realize dynamic dancing with Mambo number 5. Able to communicate with external information processing computer system to an analog interface. In the system, we perform three demonstrations. First, we realize a synchronous dancing using a rhythm verification system developed by the Synchron Laboratory. We control the tempo of the music extracted from an acceleration sensor installed on conductor's rod. Fabian dances dynamically, synchronizing its motion with the tempo of the music. Second, we realize exchange of dynamic gesture with human. Fabian recognizes human gestures through the CCD cameras installed on its AI system. The gesture recognition system is developed by Kobayashi Laboratory. Last, we realize a remote interaction using the ISDN. A remote communication system for the robot is developed in collaboration with Narita Laboratory and Professor Paolo Daria's research group from Italy. Fabian is controlled from Italy with the ISDN as the communication media. Thank you for your attention.
Elements of cooperative behavior in autonomous mobile robots. Australia.
This video demonstrates some results from research into cooperative systems. The clip shows one part of a cooperative cleaning experiment. One robot sweeps litter near the wall and deposits it in piles for the other to vacuum up by locating it visually. The robot following the wall with the square pattern on it is using a set of proportional whisker sensors we developed to wall follow. The litter in this case is just styrofoam since the actual cleaning ability is not an issue. The other robot is fitted with an onboard vacuum cleaner, a camera and a video transmitter. The video is transmitted back to a Fujitsu template matching vision system, which is used to track the position of the sweep robot based on the square pattern. The range and bearing is calculated to determine where the litter will be dumped so it can be vacuumed.
Great.
This is the same experimental run, but this time the view is from the CCD camera mounted on board the robot. You can see overlay graphics from the vision system. The small squares represent the locations of the templates being matched.
Great.
This clip shows just how robust the tracking is. The small squares represent the estimated feature positions, which are calculated by a network of Kalman filters. The Kalman filters are combining two lots of information, one from the estimated position of the template from the vision system, and the other from geometric constraints from the locations of all the other features. There is also a background search going on over the entire screen area, which allows for the initial locking on to the target, which you can see when the tracking is lost.
Viper, visual position estimation for rovers, USA.
Teleoperation of planetary rovers is a difficult and stressful task. User interfaces with raw video and maps don't convey enough information to solve these problems. In the Robotics Institute at Carnegie Mellon University, we have implemented and deployed an interface system to aid the operator with teleoperation. The Viper system estimates the position of the rover by comparing image and map features. The position estimate is displayed to increase the operator's awareness of the robot's surroundings. The system displays a map of the region being traversed, images received from the rover, and a panorama used to obtain visual features for the position estimation. The Viper system integrates three image processing components. First, a panorama is automatically generated using the images received from the rover. An image registration algorithm stitches the images into a 360-degree mosaic. The skyline is automatically extracted from the panorama and compared to skylines previously rendered from every point in the map. The posterior probability for the rover's position is calculated, and the point of highest probability is displayed. A video stabilization tool has also been developed to aid operators. It stabilizes the captured video and overlays goal information on the images. The overlays stick to goal locations, even if the camera moves. The Viper system has been deployed to the Atacama Desert of Chile in July 1997. The system was mounted on the Nomad rover, a testbed for space robotics technologies. The Atacama Desert was the main test site for the system. Experiments were also conducted with multiple panoramas and uncertainty in orientation. The system has also been tested with data from Pittsburgh, Utah, and the Moon. The position estimation was generally within 3 map cells of ground truth values.
Posture control of a cockroach-like robot. USA.
This video describes a new cockroach-like robot developed in the ongoing biologically inspired robotics program at Case Western Reserve University. Robot 2, a previous design, was inspired by the stick insect and had 3 degrees of freedom in each of its 6 legs. Joints were driven by DC motors using proportional position control. The robot could walk in a continuum of insect-like gaits and traverse irregular terrain using an insect-based distributed controller. Robot 3 is a hexapod robot modeled closely after the blabberous cockroach. The robot has an overall body length of 30 inches, which is 17 times larger than the animal. The frame of the robot is made of machined aluminum and weighs 7 pounds. The total weight of the robot is 30 pounds. Extensive simulations, including detailed kinematic analyses of cockroach locomotion from high-speed video, suggested designs and specific functions for the legs. Common to each leg are 4 basic segments, the coxa, the femur, the tibia, and the tarsus or foot. 3 degrees of freedom in each rear leg allow for a simple, powerful, piston-like motion to propel the robot. 4 degrees of freedom in each middle leg enable lifting and turning of the body. 5 degrees of freedom in each front leg give them a dexterous sensory feedback capability. The robot's 24 degrees of freedom are actuated using 36 off-the-shelf double-acting pneumatic cylinders. Each joint uses a pair of 3-way solenoid valves driven using 50 Hz pulse width modulation. Single-turn potentiometers are located at each joint, and semiconductor strain gauges are mounted on the proximal end of each tibia. 100 psi air is supplied to the valve blocks at the rear of the abdomen. The feed-forward force capability available with this actuation system provides an excellent basis for a virtual model-like postural control scheme. Observations on cockroaches indicate that the higher centers of the central nervous system are required for normal posture. This suggests that postural control is more than local reflex interaction. It is the orchestration and tuning of these reflexes according to some central desired behavior. The robot is able to sense the orientation of its own body through joint position feedback from the legs. This position information is used to stabilize and maintain posture, as well as independently control all 6 of its 3-dimensional degrees of freedom. Sets of stance legs can be encouraged to optimize force distribution among themselves, or single legs can be encouraged to push in near optimal directions. The resulting control algorithm is simple and computationally efficient. The postural controller provides good disturbance rejection and causes an insect-like swaying response. As can be seen here, the robot is very powerful. It can lift a 30-pound payload. This power also allows the robot's legs to move quickly. We believe that the cockroach-like mechanical design and this postural control framework will give the robot locomotion capabilities that approach the agility of the animal.
hydrostatic robot for marine applications, USA.
This video describes a hydrostatic robot for marine applications designed by a multidisciplinary group at Case Western Reserve University. To prove our design concepts, we built and tested the motion of a single hydrostatic segment. Four shape memory alloy springs were attached to the outside of each of two 1.5-centimeter wooden discs at 90-degree intervals. A fluid-filled bladder was inserted into the structure formed by the springs and the discs. The bladder was large enough to cause the springs to expand slightly to accommodate it, but not so large that it prevented movement when the springs were activated. 2 feet were attached to the bottom of each disc such that the segment could slide forward but would resist backward motion. The entire segment could be contracted by actuating all 4 springs, or angular motions could be achieved by compressing 1 spring or any 2 adjacent springs. 3 such segments were then coupled together to fabricate the robot. Our hydrostatic robot successfully locomoted using undulatory steps. When all of the springs along the bottom were activated, the front feet were forced down into the substrate, while the back feet were pulled towards the front of the robot. When the robot was allowed to relax from this position, the opposite movement was observed. This behavior minimized slip, allowing the robot to achieve its full range of motion. The robot also had the ability to change its orientation by nearly 20 degrees. This behavior was executed in the following manner. First, all the springs along the top of the robot were contracted in order to lift the front half of the robot off the ground. Next, the bottom springs on the side of the desired turn were actuated while simultaneously relaxing the top springs on the side away from the turning direction, causing the front segment to face in the turning direction. Finally, the bottom springs on the remaining side were contracted while the top springs on the opposite side were released so that the robot would take a crawling step in the direction faced by the front segment. In order to test the robot's overall ability to move through complex aquatic terrain, it was given a few elementary paths to follow. The first of these was to make the robot follow a bell-shaped turn that took it around 2 obstacles and into a narrow gateway, shown from the side and from above. Next, the robot was controlled to execute a 90-degree turn around an obstacle shown here from above. Note that the fluid-filled bladder and wood frame construction caused the robot to be nearly neutrally buoyant in fresh water. This video demonstrates that our robot is capable of straight-line locomotion, turning around obstacles, and locomoting through complex terrain, all within an aquatic setting. We believe that this work may serve as a foundation for the creation of hydrostatic robots capable of complex motions.
Development of a 3 degree of freedom air hockey robot, USA.
This video shows our recent progress in the development of a 3 degree of freedom air hockey playing robot. Our system consists of a 3 degree of freedom planar redundant direct drive robot, DSP-based controller, CCD camera, and vision system, all of which communicate through a VME cage to a Sun Spark 20 computer workstation. With this system, we are investigating nonlinear and hybrid control, real-time estimation, and visual servoing. An important feature of our system is that no special structure has been added to the commercial air hockey table, such as painting spots on the puck to determine spin, or constructing a flat paddle to reduce sensitivity to positioning errors. In addition, the table surface and airflow are highly irregular, and the table friction varies with position as well as temperature of the blower motor. Thus, the research challenges we face include highly nonlinear and uncertain environment dynamics, coupled with severe timing and computation constraints due to the high-speed motion of the puck, which together make it difficult to accurately estimate the motion trajectory of the puck, compute an appropriate action in response to the predicted puck motion, and move the robot into position to strike the puck back down the table all in real time. We have been inspired to a great extent by the work of Rizzi and Kotacek, who have developed a 3 degree of freedom juggling robot. While juggling can be likened to running over level ground, in the sense that both involve the establishment of stable periodic motion, air hockey can be likened to running over highly irregular and uncertain terrain where frequent gait changes are necessary and real-time vision must be used to generate suitable foot placement. Thus, robot locomotion forms an important long-term goal of our research. Our hybrid nonlinear control strategy consists of a set of nonlinear controllers, each based on the theory of nonlinear control of redundant manipulators, and each designed to achieve a particular objective. For example, moving to a blocking pose in minimum time, or reconfiguring the arm along its self-motion manifold to maximize manipulability for a strike. Our estimation scheme consists of centroid and velocity estimation that generates predicted straight-line trajectories of the puck, which are used to determine the probability of a score as well as the predicted point at which the puck would enter the goal area. A cone of possible puck trajectories is generated, and a supervisor determines the particular control to switch into the closed loop based on the size of this error cone. With a narrow cone of possible trajectories, the robot may choose an offensive strike, either straight down the table or angle shots off the wall, while a wide error cone dictates a defensive posture. Guaranteeing stability of complex nonlinear systems such as ours with real-time vision feedback and supervisors that switch among multiple nonlinear controllers is a highly non-trivial task. Much work remains to be done.
Sot Robot Soccer Systems. Korea.
Mirasot Robot Soccer Systems. The robot soccer teams Miro 2 and 32 mainly consist of a group of robots that performs cooperative actions and the host computer, which monitors the soccer field and decides strategies as per the positions of robots and of the ball. Both teams use two steering motors with encoders, an RF communication module, and rechargeable batteries. 32 uses Intel's 16-bit controller 80C196KC. Miro 2 uses Atmel's 8-bit controller A9C52 as CPUs on the robots. For vision recognition, color patches are used. The main strategy of 32 is the modified zone defense. Each robot has its own designated area of action in the field. The robots select and perform such basic actions as shoot, position to shoot, sweep ball, position to push, and block by themselves. This is the play of 32 in yellow. The controller of Miro 2 assumes a hierarchical structure. In the top layer controller, the supervisor sends commands to each robot either to attack or defend according to a flexible zone strategy where the defense line varies with the ball position. Then the corresponding attack or defense mode controller of each robot controls the robot movements. This is the play of Miro 2 in blue.
Model construction using meshes and volumes. USA.
At the Columbia Robotics Lab, we have developed a system that automatically creates 3D CAD models of objects from range imagery. A laser rangefinder is attached to a SCARA robotic arm and is used to image objects that can rotate on a turntable. The system takes a series of line scan images as it moves along its Z-axis. From these line scans, a mesh surface of the object is formed, and these surfaces are then swept in space to form a closed 3D volume of the object from a specific viewpoint. Here we see a video game controller that has been imaged by the system. This is the first view. The second view. The third view. Here is the final composite model formed by the set intersections. And the mesh surface of the object. We have used this model as input to a rapid prototyping machine and have built a scaled version of the game controller from the model. Here you can see the two side by side showing the fidelity of the recovery of the system. Planning the next view can reduce the number of scans. Here we see a composite model after two scans. The red regions are unimaged surfaces. We can compute a visibility volume that considers object self-occlusion and shows where we can place the scanner to see the unimaged surfaces. If we intersect this volume with the sphere representing the sensor's positioning capability, we are left with regions on the sphere surface that will image new parts of the object. Overlapping regions include more than one target face. In the back row are some objects that have been acquired by the system, and in front of them are the models that have been built on a rapid prototyping machine. The system can recover a wide range of 3D shapes, including holes, concavities, and curved surfaces.
CWRU Flexible Parts Feeding System, USA.
This video describes a flexible parts feeding system developed at Case Western Reserve University. The feeding system includes three conveyors working together to present parts to a work cell. The first conveyor is inclined and lifts parts from a bulk hopper. By varying the angle and motion profile of the conveyor, a wide variety of parts are deliverable. Parts slide down a ramp at the end of the inclined conveyor onto the horizontal conveyor, which terminates within the working envelope of the robot, where an underlit vision window is located. Vision algorithms are used to determine the location of singulated parts. Parts which are overlapping or are in orientations not suitable for assembly drop from the end of the horizontal conveyor and onto the return conveyor. Closed-loop servo control is used to drive the inclined and horizontal conveyors, while a fixed-speed motor drives the return conveyor. The feeder control system begins by advancing the inclined and horizontal conveyors simultaneously. The horizontal conveyor is advanced a distance approximately equal to its length. Depending on their characteristics, the parts may be shaken by a rapid back and forth motion of the conveyor belts. These motions singulate and reorient parts on the horizontal conveyor and produce a more even flow of parts from the inclined conveyor. When all of the favorably oriented parts in the vision window have been acquired, the horizontal conveyor advances a predetermined distance while the inclined conveyor remains stationary. When the horizontal conveyor is empty, both the inclined and horizontal conveyors advance. Loading the horizontal conveyor in this manner improves the throughput of the system. Many different parts have been fed using the feeder: plastic snap rings, clear plastic discs, plastic sockets, and hex nuts are some examples. Multiple parts, such as plastic sockets and two different sizes of hex nuts, have also been fed simultaneously. The vision system differentiates between the parts, and the robot sorts them into different bins. Data was taken to determine feeder throughput. The feeder can present about 100 small parts per minute to the vision system. Vision processing time reduced this number to 15 to 20 parts per minute. Operating the robot at 75% of its rated speed further reduced throughput to an average of 10 parts per minute. This example demonstrates the strong dependence of feeder throughput on robot and vision speed. These results were obtained with the three steps, feed, identify, and grasp, proceeding sequentially. We expect that parallelizing these steps will increase feeding rates significantly. In conclusion, a flexible parts feeder has been designed, constructed, and shown to feed a wide variety of parts. This work was supported by the Cleveland Advanced Manufacturing Program and by corporate sponsors.
Technologies for robust agile manufacturing. USA.
This video describes enabling technologies for unattended operation of an agile work cell performing light mechanical assembly. Our work cell exploits modular hardware and software design to permit manufacture of a wide range of products, rapid introduction of new assemblies, and quick changeover between products. The work cell includes two Adept 550 and two Adept 1 robots, a Bosch flexible conveyor system for transferring assemblies, and our own flexible feeders capable of presenting a wide variety of parts for assembly. Previously, our agile manufacturing work cell relied on open-loop software timers for controlling hardware, causing long cycle times and making error detection difficult. We have recently incorporated a number of dedicated sensors to monitor assembly operations, reducing cycle times and enabling automated error detection. We are currently pursuing the use of flexible sensors, which can perform multiple duties. The ability to reuse a work cell component in the assemblies of different products is crucial to decreasing cost and reducing changeover time. A CCD camera coupled to our machine vision system replaces dedicated hardware such as through-beam or proximity sensors. Later, a low-cost CMOS camera will be used. This single flexible sensor is used to monitor four assembly operations: successful insertion of a part into a fixture, attachment of another part, success of the assembly operation, and removal of the completed assembly from the fixture. The system attempts to recover from certain assembly operation failures without calling an operator for assistance. In this example, a plastic snap ring is intentionally removed from the gripper. The flexible sensor detects the part's absence, and the robot picks another snap ring from the feeder. Defective assemblies are detected by the system at the point of failure and discarded. Most common errors are detected and resolved using separate error recovery routines, reducing the changes needed in our software when new routines are introduced. Information about an error requiring operator assistance is transmitted to a graphical simulator, which shows the event to the operator and suggests how the error may be resolved. We have also developed a CAD-based gripper design and fabrication method extending flexibility to grippers and fixtures. Gripper surfaces conforming to part surfaces are computed, laser cut layer by layer, and assembled to complete gripper fabrication. As shown here, grippers can be designed to handle multiple distinct shapes through the superposition of CAD part models. This example demonstrates rapid gripper design, high reliability in handling a variety of parts, and improved grasp precision. Finally, this Symmetrics controller retrofit to an Adept 1 robot exemplifies our accommodation of heterogeneous subsystems. Our use of network communications and generic robot commands in C++ shields the programmer from vendor-specific details. In summary, we have developed error detection and recovery techniques and other technologies necessary to achieve unattended operation of an agile manufacturing work cell.
Two industrial robot manipulators rigidly holding an egg, Belgium.
This video presents three segments of experiments to demonstrate the feasibility of the new framework of general constrained robots. They are: 1, a single arm rigid robot in contact with a very rigid environment; 2, two industrial robots with rigid end effectors in contact with each other, subject to rigid unilateral constraints; and 3, two robots rigidly holding a raw egg. The demonstrations presented in this video give very smooth and stable contact with rigid constraints. It also indicates that with the aid of advanced force control algorithms, conventional industrial robots possess the capability to perform very delicate operations.
Therefore, it highlights the potential applications of robots in the service area. The work presented in this video was performed in the robotics laboratory of PMA, Catholique Universiteit Leuven, Belgium.
Under actuated robotic hand, Canada.
A robust underactuated hand has been developed in the robotics laboratory at Laval University. The hand is capable of grasping objects of various shapes and of significant mass. Each of the three fingers is driven by two actuators, namely, one for the closing of the three phalanges and one for the orientation of the finger. Hence, the hand comprises six actuators and has 12 degrees of freedom. An underactuated linkage, including springs and mechanical limits, allows the fingers to automatically conform to the shape of the object being grasped. Therefore, the 3 degrees of freedom are controlled by one single actuator. An additional mechanism maintains the distal phalanges parallel when performing pinch grasps. The concept of a 3 degree of freedom underactuated finger has first been tested using cardboard models. Then, the geometric parameters have been determined using numerical simulations. A CAD system has been used for the mechanical design of the hand. Since the base of the fingers can be oriented arbitrarily, the hand can grasp a variety of objects. The chair is being held using a cylindrical grasp. This mandrel is being handled using a spherical grasp, in which all the fingers are oriented towards a common point. The ball is being lifted using a planar two-finger grasp. Note the action of the parallel mechanism which facilitates the grasping of small objects. This grasp illustrates the adaptation of the fingers to an object and the capability of the hand to maintain a grasp in the presence of external perturbations. The hand is capable of handling large loads in different orientations. For instance, this barbell is being lifted from the side. This person is being lifted from the top using a bar. In this case, the maximum load is 155 pounds, or 70 kilograms. Although tactile sensors are mounted on the phalanges, the only sensors used in the present version of the controller are the position and the force of the actuator. This control mode leads to reliable grasps with the use of a minimum number of sensors.
A 3D deformable shape sensor, USA.
We have developed a new image-based tactile sensor that localizes contact in three dimensions by reconstructing the shape of the fingertip surface online. The operation of our tactile sensor is based on the use of a fluid-supported membrane. Its properties are much better suited to applications like manipulation than those of conventional robotic sensors. Local deformations are not transmitted well spatially in materials that obey Hooke's law.
On the other hand, fluid-filled membranes distribute pressure everywhere throughout the enclosed volume because of the constant pressure of the fluid inside. Our sensor consists of a roughly elliptical latex membrane, a camera, and a fiber optic light guide. The membrane is filled with a clear gel and sealed by a transparent window. A grid of dots is drawn on the membrane at precisely computed locations. Deforming the membrane causes a shift in the pattern of dots as viewed by the camera. Our algorithm compares dot locations in the current image to their undeformed locations to obtain their optical displacement. The displacement is then used to compute the deformed 3D membrane surface, represented as a grid of points. The undeformed location of each dot on the membrane is known a priori. As the membrane is deformed, a new image location is observed for each dot. Projective geometry tells us there exist an infinity of solutions for the 3D coordinates of the dots. One solution is depicted here. Under deformation, the membrane assumes a shape which minimizes its stored energy. Also, the volume enclosed by the membrane remains constant. These constraints, together with some genericity assumptions on the group of points, are sufficient to obtain a solution for the 3D coordinate of the grid of dots. Currently, our sensor can reconstruct the shape of the tactile surface at a rate of 8 Hz. The point of contact and surface normal are computed online. Future work is directed toward the development of a two-finger dexterous manipulator. With improved accuracy, the sensor could determine the local surface curvature of objects that it contacts.
Use of sensors with soft contact surfaces for handling flat objects. Yugoslavia.
To measure forces arising on the contact between the gripper and the grasped object, we propose to use sensors with soft contact surfaces. Each sensor consists of three sensing cells. On the sensor ends, normal forces are measured in the middle of the tangential one. On the complete gripper, normal forces are measured in 8, tangentially in 4 points, spatially distributed. In our previous experiments, the sensors were placed around the cylindrical object. In the following experiments, to enable grasping of flat objects, two pairs of parallelly placed sensors were used. Using information from all sensors properly, object inclination in both directions as well as translation in the tangential direction can be controlled. Due to poor communication characteristics between PC and robot controller, object motion is not quite smooth. It is not easy to perform smoothly hole-on-peg task even by human hand. Very small contact forces cause inclination of the grasped object and jamming. Using these sensors to control contact forces and object inclination task can be successfully realized even if position of the peg is changed during the task realization. In the first phase of insertion of the object of squared cross-section with unknown exact hole position, permanent contact is ensured by measurement of axial force, while change of forces caused by object inclination are used for hole detection. In the next phase, tangential force ensures object insertion, while object inclination should be decreased to enable task progression.